Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video I want to go over the neurological assessment. I get a ton of questions about physical assessment, and in particular the neuro part of the assessment, because there's a lot of terms that you have to know, and there's just a lot of intricacies about the neuro part of the assessment that makes it kind of one of the more difficult parts to learn. So in this video, we're going to just talk about the most important parts of the assessment, of the neuro assessment. You're going to be doing these things every single time you go into your patient's room to perform a head-to-toe assessment. And then I'm also going to talk about how to assess each one of the cranial nerves that is not addressed in this first part, because I know you will be tested over that, and the cranial nerves is a big pain point for a lot of you guys. So let's just dig right in and start talking about the neuro assessment. So everybody knows that level of consciousness is the most sensitive and most basic indicator of how your patient is doing neurologically, all right? And so level of consciousness just means how awake and alert your patient is. So at the very top of the scale, a patient can be awake and alert, right? Like I am right now. Then the next level down, if you will, would be a lethargic patient. Now this is a patient that falls asleep easily, maybe when you're talking to them, but they're also very easily aroused. Okay, so that's lethargy. Then the next step down from lethargy would be a term called obtunded. Now, these patients, they fall asleep very easily. They are difficult to arouse. Unlike your lethargic patient, you may have to go in and shake them a little bit to wake them up. But when you wake them up, for the most part, they're going to be appropriate. They're going to talk to you in sentences and in words. You're going to be able to understand them, but they are very, very difficult to arouse. Next is what we call or refer to as stuporous. Now, this is the level of consciousness that patients are in, and this is just barely above being comatose, all right? So a stuporous patient, very difficult to arouse. If you are able to arouse them, you're going to get maybe some grunts and some groans, but they're not going to make any sense to you. They're not going to be able to form words. They're not going to be able to answer any questions. You're going to shake them. And like I said, if you're able to wake them up, you may get a grunt or a groan or something like that. And that's stuporous. And then obviously the very last level is going to be comatose, and these patients don't wake up. They're in a coma. So that is level of consciousness. Do not confuse level of consciousness with mental status. Two very different things. And mental status is included in our Glasgow Coma Scale. So you know that we're doing our Glasgow Coma Scale on our adult patients that are in the hospital. The lowest number you can get on the Glasgow Coma Scale is a 3. A dead body can get a 3 on the Glasgow Coma Scale. And the highest number would be a 15. So what we're looking at with the Glasgow Coma Scale are 3 different areas of your patient's neurological overall status. So we're looking at motor. All right, so a patient that you go into the room and you say, squeeze my hands. All right, they get full points for motor reaction. All right, but if you have a patient that does not obey commands, you have to go one step down on the Glasgow Coma Scale under that motor section, and you have to actually try to inflict pain on your patient. And there's 2 levels of response to pain before we get into something called posturing. Now, one response is that you go in and say you pinch the skin over their sternum, and they reach over and they're able to brush your hand away. All right, we call that localizing pain. And that's much better than the next step that I'm about to talk about. So you pinch them, they're able to localize it by brushing your hand away. The next step is called withdrawal from pain. And what would happen there is you go in and you pinch that same spot on their sternum, and they just kind of move or turn or, you know, rear back or raise up in the bed or whatever. They're just withdrawing from the pain, but they're not able to localize the pain and actually push your hand away. So that's worse. They get less of a score if they're only able to withdraw as opposed to localize. Then next we get into our posturing. So you're going to see two different types of posturing depending on your patient's neurostatus. The first level is called decorticate posturing. This is when you go in and you inflict some sort of noxious stimuli. Most often it's pain, and they draw their arms into the core, okay? Or they flex their arms in. This is called decorticate posturing. The next level, or the next level of response to that noxious stimuli, would be decerebrate posturing. And this is when the patient hyperextends their arms out and hyperpronates their wrists outward. So that's decerebrate, and that's worse than decorticate, all right? Then finally, the patient that doesn't do anything in response to noxious stimuli gets a 1, so that's the lowest level. All right, so the next thing we're testing is verbal. So this is really where you're able to determine your patient's mental status, because if your patient is oriented to person, place, time, situation, then they get full points for verbal. If they're a little bit confused, they get fewer points. Then the next level down from that is they're answering you in sentences, but they're not really making much sense. Then you move on down to, okay, they're making like incomprehensible sounds and you're not able to like understand them at all. Then finally, if they give you no verbal response whatsoever, then they get a 1, which is the lowest level. Verbal response is really, in my opinion, and it's in my experience as an educator, it's a lot easier to grade than motor response. So I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on verbal, but I do want to just briefly go over a few terms that pertain to mental status. So obviously the best mental status for your patient is to be oriented. They can be confused, all right? But a patient that has a level of consciousness, they can be awake and alert, which is their level of consciousness, but also be confused at the same time, okay? So that's why I say don't confuse your level of consciousness with your mental status. Two different things. So you've got confusion. You can have agitation. You can have delirium. Delirium is a big thing within the ICU now. There's a lot of shifting of evidence-based practice ideas in relation to delirium, especially in the ICU. All right, so that's mental status. Finally, the eye opening, this is kind of self-explanatory also. So if you walk into the room and your patient's eyes are just open spontaneously, they get full points. If you have to speak to them to wake them up, but they wake up to voice, then they get 1 less point. But that's still okay, because your patient could just be taking a nap, but they wake up when you talk to them. The next level down is you actually have to pinch your patient or inflict noxious stimuli to get them to open their eyes. And then finally, they're not going to open their eyes at all. All right, so that would give them a 1. So again, Glasgow Coma Scale, the highest you can get is a 15, and this is a patient who is awake, alert, their eyes are open when you walk into the room, and they're able to follow your commands appropriately, answer all your questions appropriately. So that's the Glasgow Coma. The next thing we check every time we do a physical assessment is the patient's pupils. So everybody knows what PERLA stands for. It stands for Pupils Equal, Round, Reactive to Light and Accommodation. And when you're looking at reactive to light, obviously that's when you're shining the light in their eyes. I always tell my patient to look at my nose when I'm shining the light in their eyes. That way the light doesn't blind them. And you're looking for bilateral constriction when the light is shined in their eyes. Now with accommodation, this is where you ask your patient to focus on something very close, like you may hold your pen up in front of them and they focus on that pen, and then you ask them to focus on something far away, like tell them to look at the clock on the wall. Well, when their focus shifts to the object that's far away, their pupil should dilate, all right? And so that's accommodation, accommodating to something that's far away. Their pupils dilate to help them see that object better. Size, do not forget to look at your patient's pupil size, all right? Are the pupils equal? Now, we've already established that they're round and equal, but you have to assign a size. Most patients' pupils are going to be a 2, but most of the time you're going to have one of those little charts that shows you pupil size and what number to assign. Most patients' pupils are going to be 2 to 3, maybe a 1 would kind of be small. Anything larger than a 4 is kind of really dilated pupils. They may have had some medication or something that left their pupils dilated, but don't forget to document the size of your patient's pupils and look at that when you're checking Perla. Now, by checking Perla and pupil size, you have already addressed cranial nerves number 2 and 3. Cranial nerve number 2 is the optic nerve that assesses vision, visual acuity. Cranial nerve number 3 assesses pupil constriction and dilation. So you've already knocked out cranial nerve 2 and 3. Next, we're moving down to EOMs, or extraocular movements. Now this is the 6 cardinal fields of gaze, to where you have your patient follow your pen through the 6 cardinal fields of gaze, all right? And if they are able to do that without nystagmus, then you're going to chart EOMs intact, okay? But if they start following your pen and you start seeing their eyes wiggle like this, that's called nystagmus. That's a negative response, and you've got to make note of that, all right? So by checking EOMs, or by checking extraocular movement, you've knocked out cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6, okay? So just by doing eyes alone, you have checked 2, 3, 4, and 6 out of all your cranial nerves. Pretty cool, huh? And then finally, we're checking grips and strength. So when you have your patient squeeze your hand, you are going to assign them a number based on their strength. But honestly, that's not what we're looking for. As far as, I don't care if my 90-year-old patient is very strong. What I do care about is that their grips are equal, okay? Same thing with leg strength. When you have your patient push against your hands, you're assessing for equality of strength, not that your patient is strong or weak or whatever. If they're weak equally, then that's not a problem. That's not a neurological problem. That's a muscular problem, right? But if one leg or one arm is much stronger than the other, then that could indicate a neurological problem such as a stroke. So this is just a real quick overview of the neurological assessment. You're going to be doing these things every time you assess your patient. You may be doing these things more often as a focused assessment if your patient is presenting with a neurological problem. So if we have a patient that we're worried about increased intracranial pressure, or they've had a stroke, or they have some kind of other neurological insult, you may be performing these assessments much more often. All right, so I hope this has helped you. I feel like maybe we need to make a whole nother video about checking the remainder of the cranial nerves, but we'll get to that real quick. And I just hope you've learned something from this video. Please, please, please hit that subscribe button if you like what you see. If you're watching this from YouTube, head over to thedoctornurse.com. I promise you will not be disappointed. There are tons of other videos there, tons of other resources, lots of resources for pathophysiology, there's resources for pharmacology, all kinds of good stuff. The Pathopedia books are uploaded. I'm working on the Neuropathopedia book right now. Hope to get that out real soon. And again, thank you so much for watching, and I just really hope that you guys got something out of this video today.